leaving me with conviction in a heart, crying out to the heavens on the plains of Arafat, standing proud beside my brother, silent at Muzdalifa.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam and my dear brothers and sisters in humanity, I welcome all of you with the greetings of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, we are going through a series of interviews on a very interesting and a heart-touching and a soul-soothing topic of the virtues of the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. And to enlighten us on this subject, we have our dear Sheikh from UK, Sheikh Dr. Haitham Al-Haddad. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi
wa barakatuh. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sheikh, alhamdulillah, we have done quite a good number of episodes talking about the various virtues and the various rulings pertaining to the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. And in the previous episode, we spoke about the day of Arafah and its virtues. There is one issue which we have to discuss related to the day of Arafah, that there is a concept of dhikr mutlaq and dhikr muqayyad. So what is this concept? Would you like to please tell our audiences that what is the difference between the dhikr mutlaq and dhikr muqayyad?
Okay, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. You know, we said that the acts of ibadah in general are heavily regulated by Sharia. However, with certain acts of ibadah, there is a level of flexibility within the guidelines. For example, the dhikr. Certain types of dhikr should be followed strictly. Certain types of dhikr are heavily regulated by Sharia, and so we have to follow the sunnah carefully, accurately, strictly. For example, in the adhkar of the morning, the adhkar of the evening, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever says bismillah alladhi la yadurru ma'a ismihi shay'un fil ardi wa la fis sama' wa huwa as-sami'ul 'alim, three times, nothing will harm him in the morning and the evening. You can't say bismillah alladhi la yadurru ma'a ismihi shay'un fil ardi wa la fis sama' wa huwa al-'azizul hakim.
Though it is good, but
it
yet
is good. No, do it as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us to do it.
Mashallah.
Okay, this is in general. On the other side, there are types of dhikr that the Prophet ﷺ made it open for us. For example, the Prophet ﷺ said, لَأَنْ أَقُولَ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَالْحَمْدِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسِ. To say سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَالْحَمْدِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ is better than the dunya, the entire dunya. Mm-hmm. Yeah? The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever says سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ, a plant, a tree will be planted for him in Jannah. A tree is not like those trees. Huh? Yeah? The Prophet ﷺ once described the tree that you need 1,000, or the rider needs 1,000 years in order to travel around it.
Allahu Akbar.
So this, is there any limit how many times you say Subhanallah? Or Subhanallah bihamdi, Subhanallah al-Azim, kalimatani khafifatani ala lisan, two words. Easy on the tongue, heavy on the scale, pleasing to Allah.
Definitely.
Is there any limit? Say
no
them.
Limit.
100 times, 200 times, 300 times, 170 times, 60 times, whatever. Say Subhanallah bihamdi, Subhanallah al-Azim, Subhanallah bihamdi, Subhanallah al-Azim, anytime. Okay? So, some dhikr, some adhkar are restricted in terms of time, place, number. But other types of adhkar, they are not restricted. Mm-hmm. Same thing, the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala and takbir during these 10 days. The scholar said there is mutlaq, unrestricted dhikr. So during these days, you just say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, or Subhanallah bihamdi, Subhanallah al-Azim, Subhanallah bihamdi, Subhanallah al-Azim, Subhanallah bihamdi, Subhanallah al-Azim. Or you make 10,000 times La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu, lahul mulk wa lahul hamdu wa huwa ala kulli shayin qadir. This dhikr is what? Unrestricted, unconditional. This scholar said that it was reported through some of the tabi'een that they used to do some restricted dhikr. alongside with the unrestricted dhikr. In particular, after the congregational prayers, they used to make dhikr. They used to make takbir, tasbih, tahmid, etc.
This would be the dhikr muqayyad.
This is the dhikr muqayyad. This is what the scholars say, the dhikr muqayyad. After fard salah in congregation. Yeah, the people, not as a gathering dhikr, no, everyone by himself, but loudly. They say the dhikr. طيب. Obviously, you know, it was reported three forms of dhikr, or maybe more than that, to say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, wa lillahi alhamd, or to say it three times, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, and then Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, wa lillahi alhamd, or Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, and then different forms, which means that the matter is flexible.
Flexible.
So this is dhikr muqayyad. Dhikr mutlaq continues from the beginning of Dhul Hijjah, yeah, up to the 13th of Dhul Hijjah.
Okay.
Up to the 13th of Dhul Hijjah is what? The last day of Tashriq.
Tashriq.
And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ayyamu Tashriq, Ayyamu Aklin wa Shurbin wa Dhikrin Lillah. There are days for eating, drinking, and dhikr of Allah.
Remembrance of Allah.
So this is unconditional. Do it anytime. Now the conditional, the restricted one, they said for the non-Hajji people, those who did not go for Hajj, they are not doing talbiyah. Mm-hmm. So for them, they started the dhikr from the morning of Arafah. They pray Fajr and then they start the dhikr all the way until the 13th of Dhul Hijjah, after every salah. After Fajr, after Dhuhr, after Asr, Maghrib, and Isha.
The non-Hajjis, they start from the 9th of Dhul Hijjah.
The 9th of Dhul Hijjah. Yeah, after Fajr, after Dhuhr, after Asr, after Maghrib. Okay? But for the Hajji people, during Hajj, during Ihram, it's better for them to be engaged in what? In Talbiyah. When they remove their Ihram on the 10th day, and the 10th day, because they will go for stoning first, and then Nahr, and then Tawaf, and then they will come back to Mina. When they come back to Mina, khalas, they have removed their Ihram. So the Sunnah for them is no more Talbiyah for them. So the Sunnah for them is to start the restricted conditional Dhikr.
Okay.
Which is, okay, after Dhuhr, Asr, again, after Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, up to
the 13th.
The 13th.
Inshallah.
Yeah? Whenever they remove Ihram, up to the 13th after the Salawat.
Okay, mashallah. So we learned that, alhamdulillah, there is one zikr mutlaq, which is to be done right from the first day of Dhul Hijjah until the 13th for those of them who are not performing the Hajj. For the Hujjaj, they have both. They do the talbiyah during the days, and on the 10th, that is the Yomun Nahr, after they have removed their ihram and they have sorted and they put on their regular clothes, they start with the zikr muqayyad,
yes,
which is the takbir, that which we do normally. Jazakallah, yes, khair, Shaykh. Let's move on to the final day, the day of Yomun Nahr.
Yes.
The 10th of Dhul Hijjah. So what are its virtues and what are the different rulings related to this day?
Jazakallah khair. Yawmun Nahr, as we said, there is a hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said the best of the days is Yawmun Nahr. Some scholars said it is better even than Yawmun Arafah. Most of the scholars believe that Yawmun Arafah is better. Anyway, the matter is, okay, a matter of disagreement between the scholars. Again, once we talk about Yawmun Nahr, are we talking about the 10th day of Dhul Hijjah for the Hujjaj? Or are we talking about the 10th day of Dhul Hijjah for the non-Hujjaj?
So we need to make that reference clear.
Yes. Okay. It seems that, again, most of the ahadith that talk about the virtues of the last day of the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, which is Yawmun Nahr, the 10th, they talk about it for the Hujjaj. But, again, as we said about the day of Arafah, the Rahmah of Allah Jalla wa Ala can extend to cover the non-Hajji or the non-Hujjaj.
Okay.
So it is still, even for those who did not go for Hajj, it is a very virtuous day. However, we do not fast in it. So this is the first ruling. It is the day of Eid.
Eid.
And we have two Eids in Islam. Eid al-Fitr.
And Eid al-Adha.
And Eid al-Adha. When the Prophet ﷺ came to Medina and he found them enjoying their time and playing in one of the days, he said, what is this? They said, this is the Eid of so-and-so. He said, no. Allah Jalla wa Ala gave me better Eids. What are those better Eids? The Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha.
MashaAllah.
And then he said, these are our Eid, the people of Islam. So we as Muslims have two or three Eids. Eid al-Fitr, Eid al-Adha. And Jum'ah, it was narrated in some ahadith and some statements of the early scholars that it is also our Eid, which is the weekly Eid.
MashaAllah.
Other than that, we do not have any Eid.
MashaAllah. So we need to recognize them as the symbols of Islam and we need to celebrate them with all the enjoyment in a halal way, alhamdulillah. Inshallah, we will take a break now and we will resume to continue talking about the day of Eid and its various rulings.
Crying out to the heavens on the plains of Arafat.
Of the world ban bullying. They fight it in their schools and universities. A lot of us are being bullied differently every single day. Some come up to us and say, do this, while others say, don't you dare. Some say this is halal, halal, while others say, nope, this is haram.
Haram.
Are you confused?
Are you confused?
Do you feel lost? Join me in Umdat al-Ahkam, where, with the grace of Allah, we will learn the proper knowledge from the Quran and from the Sunnah, which would help stop this kind of bullying.
Join Asim Al-Hakim in Umdatul Ahkam, next on Peace TV.
Crying out to the heavens on the plains of Arafat.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back after the break. Sheikh, we were talking about the day of Eid, that is the Yawmun Nahr, and its virtues.
Yes. So we said that it is a Eid for us. What should we do? The first ruling is we are not allowed to fast.
It's haram.
The Prophet ﷺ prohibited that. If we fast, it is haram and it is invalid as well. This is the first ruling. The second ruling, for the non-Hajj people, it is highly recommended that they attend the Eid Salah. Highly recommended. For the Hajji people, obviously, their Eid Salah, as some scholars said, is to stone the Jamrat al-Aqaba. Because this is the Sunnah for them, is to leave Muzdalifah before Shuruq, and directly, they need to go directly to Mina.
Mina.
They will reach Mina after Shuruq, which is the time for what? For Eid Salah.
For the Eid Salah.
It is the time. The Eid Salah is to be performed after
the Shuruq.
The Shuruq. A few minutes after the Shuruq, 15 minutes or so after the Shuruq, which is likely the time we or people arrive to Mina. Now, as you know, people arrive to Mina much later than this. So they will perform what? Stoning. This is like the Salah of Eid for them, like the Salah of Eid. So it is not Sunnah for them to leave that Rami in order to perform Salah of Eid. But for the non-Hajj people, it is Sunnah for them to go for Salah. And as Umm Atiyya radiallahu ta'ala anha, one of the great female companions, she said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam commanded us to take for Eid, to attend Eid, women who are in their menses, young ladies, and those girls who have reached the age of puberty as well. All
of them.
To go. For those sisters or for those women who are having their menses, they can stay away from the gathering during the Salah. They just stay away from the gathering during the Salah. Why? The Prophet ﷺ said, يَشْهَدْنَا الْخَيْرِ. They attend the dua of the Muslims, the takbir of the Muslims, the gathering of the Muslims.
What is more important is the gathering of
yes,
the Muslims.
Yes. Now, many scholars believe that Salatul Eid is wajib. Wajib. They said it is one of the symbols of Islam. One of the symbols of Islam. And that's why we need to keep this Salah, to perform this Salah everywhere we go. Because subhanAllah, I'm living in the West. It is really one of the symbols of Muslim. On their Eid day, they go, they dress well, and they go to perform their Salah. In some countries, unfortunately, what is left for Muslims is to pray Eid. They don't pray Jum'ah, they don't pray other prayers, but they come and pray their Eid. So this is the most important thing. Now, what is the philosophy of Eid, you know, from an Islamic perspective, as we are talking about it? Eid is to make takbir of Allah, shukr of Allah, to be thankful to Allah, to glorify Allah, to establish the oneness of Allah. This is the main element of the Eid. Other elements, wearing nice clothes, celebrating it, are secondary elements.
Okay.
And to do this while you are attending the gathering of Muslims, and this gives you a sense of happiness and being proud of or being confident of your deen. It gives a positive message. And this is the meaning of the Eid.
MashaAllah.
This is the essence of the Eid. Because many people, I met a few converted brothers and sisters, and they do not understand what are we celebrating. Okay, they don't understand the meaning of the Eid. In fact, if we want to be more accurate, Allah Jalla wa Ala said about Eid al-Fitr, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم. The one who witnesses the month, he should fast the month. ومن كان منكم مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر. يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر. Allah desires ease for you, and Allah does not desire hardship for you. ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم. And you complete the count. What does that mean? As the scholar said, once Allah Jalla wa Ala has given us the chance to fast the month of Ramadan, we should be happy celebrating that opportunity that was granted to us.
Allah.
This is the philosophy of it. So Eid for us and those days of celebrations, we are not celebrating dunya. We are not celebrating any matter. We don't know what is it. We are celebrating that Allah Jalla wa Ala has given us this chance. And that's why we glorify Him. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And that's why it is the sunnah in the Eid, whether Eid Fitr or Eid al-Adha, to leave to the Salah while what? Making takbir.
Loud for the men and for the women, for quietly.
Yes, loudly for men and for women. They can do it among themselves, not to cause fitna. Okay? Of course, normally when we say loud, it is if you can do it even in non-Muslim countries loudly without causing harm, yeah, do it. But if you are going to cause harm, طيب, then don't do it. But the issue is, don't be embarrassed.
That's correct. You should not feel shy.
Yes. because this is part of our religion. Islamic identity, part of our way of life, part of our religion. طيب الله جل وعلا says وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Same thing they said, the sunnah for Salatul Eid al-Adha is to leave to your house glorifying Allah جل وعلا, making takbir. They also said quickly about the sunnah of the Eid is that the sunnah for Eid al-Fitr is to delay the salah a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so people will eat before going to Eid.
Mm-hmm.
For Eid al-Adha, the sunnah is the opposite. Bring the salah forward.
That's right.
This is for the imam, in order for people to go immediately and slaughter. And the sunnah for them is to break their fast on their udhiyah, if possible.
If possible.
And we said that the udhiyah, the time to slaughter the udhiyah starts after what?
After the offering of the Eid salah.
The Eid salah. Again, so we said the sunnah is that everyone goes for the Eid Salah. Women in their menses, they can stay aside. Obviously, they will not pray the Salat al-Eid, but they will attend the khair and the dua of the Muslims. They said also it is sunnah to wear the best clothes or nice clothes or new clothes, whatever. Umar ibn al-Khattab wanted to buy something for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, good clothes, a good aba'a. He said, in order to wear it during Eid. So they understood from this that it is sunnah to wear
the best of clothes available.
Also, Ibn Umar used to have a shower, ghusl, before going to the Eid. This is again sunnah of the Eid. Also, they said that you can extend greetings between yourselves. Okay, Mubarak for the Eid. Kullu aam antum bikhir. The matter is flexible. They also said that it is good to spend more on your family.
Definitely.
On the day of the Eid.
As well as walking towards the musalla, yeah. Taking one path and changing the path.
And coming
while
from
returning.
Another path. In terms of the salah of the Eid, now the imams, they know how to perform the salah, but the sunnah for salah, quickly, is to perform two rak'ah before the khutbah. So you attend the place, the imam will come to the gathering of the people, and he will start with the salah, two rak'ah. Two rak'ah, and the first rak'ah, he will do seven takbirs after takbirat al-ihram. So he will say, Allahu Akbar, as a opening takbir, and then he will say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, the takbir is seven after takbirat al-ihram, the first rak'ah, and five in the second rak'ah. And then the imam, after the salat al-eid, he should go to the pulpit, if there is a pulpit, and he should give again, two khutbas. Most of the scholars believe that two khutbas, similar to the Jum'ah, and after the two khutbas, he can leave and the people can leave. People even can leave during the two khutbas. As the scholar said, it is not wajib to attend them. It is good to attend them.
MashaAllah.
Some scholars believe that it is one khutbah. Anyway, it is a matter of disagreement.
Related to this is that if the Eid falls on the day of Jum'ah, so is there any concession that a person can either attend Eid Salah or Jummah?
The scholars have different views regarding it. One view says if you pray one, don't pray the other. To be on the safe side, pray both. Except for those who have to travel long distances to attend
to the Eid Salah.
The Eid or the Jummah.
Mm-hmm.
So it is not feasible for them to attend both.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe this is applicable in some small towns. People don't have any place to pray their Eid or to pray their Jum'ah, or it's difficult for them to travel to pray Eid and then to travel again to pray Jum'ah.
Mm-hmm.
But apart from this, where the masajid are there, it's better to be on the safe side and pray both of them. Yeah, this will cover most of the rulings regarding the Eid, and this will, inshallah, by this we have covered most of the rulings regarding the first 10 days of Al-Hijjah.
Jazakallah khairan, Shaykh. Alhamdulillah. We have covered many of the virtues of the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, and it was a real source of inspiration. May Allah reward you with abundant good, Shaykh. And Jazakallah for coming all the way from UK to give your valuable and precious time to share your knowledge of Islam, and especially the knowledge that which has been gained in the series of the virtues of the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. We pray for you that inshallah you join us again and come to India and give more such wonderful series for the benefit of the audience on Peace TV. And Jazakallah Khair for being with us for this entire series. And we hope and we pray to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, so whatever we have learned in this series, we implement it in our lives. It is for myself as well as for all the viewers that we strive our utmost best to implement the knowledge that which we gain. And inshallah, we pray to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala that He accepts our worship and He accepts this series as a sawab-e-jariya for all the team members of this series. Jazakallahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
All across ocean and land, incumbent on all men, is the pilgrimage to Mecca, fifth pilgrimage.